Hello, and welcome to the Family Histories Podcast, the show for and about those of us who are sat quietly in libraries, archives, and spare rooms all around the world, tirelessly piecing together our collective social and family history. My name is Andrew Martin. I'm a family historian, and I'll be your host. In this episode, The Unexpected, we'll be hearing about how my guests' decades of research are turned upside down by a DNA test, and then we'll be trying to find the right baby in the villages of Herefordshire in 19th century England. So, put down that old newspaper, grab a cuppa, and let's meet our guest. My guest today has spent 40 years working within the genealogy community and is the genealogist at the Society of Genealogists. She has helped to bring conferences and educational programs to life, enabling us family historians to grow our skills, our knowledge, and professionalism. She has also represented our voice by advising at national and governmental level. So, before I get catalogued and filed away, I better introduce my guest, Elsa Churchill. Hello, Elsa. Welcome to the Family Histories Podcast.
Hello, Andrew. Thank you for inviting me.
You're extremely welcome. 40 years working within genealogy. Let's take a few steps back and find out, you know, where did all this begin?
I am one of the rare people that actually started working in genealogy before I actually started tracing my own family history.
Okay.
I came out of university in the 80s, in the early 80s, knowing I wanted to work with history, but not knowing what kind of opportunities there might be available to me. And I was lucky enough to have an introduction, and I was studying in Kent, at the University of Kent in Canterbury, and that's where the Institute for Heraldic and Genealogical Studies is based.
Okay.
And I had an introduction to the Institute and thought this seemed intriguing and something interesting I'd like to do. So they invited me to come on what I suppose you'd retrospectively think of it as some kind of apprenticeship scheme where they would take, you know, recent graduates through and bring them into the world of researching genealogy with their library and their professional research company that was also associated with the Institute. But I kind of even sidestepped again because they were in need of a librarian. The former librarian, sadly, had literally died on the job.
Oh, okay.
And had a heart attack in the library. And was and so they were pretty much thinking, you know, are you interested in the library at all? And I thought, always, it's books. Of course I am. So I kind of sidestepped into running the library, and I took my postgraduate library qualifications while I was working at the Institute and started running their library, started doing some casework with them, realised I didn't really like casework and doing professional genealogy for other people.
Okay.
I really liked enabling and helping researchers find resources they needed and helping other people to become genealogists. So I started doing a bit of teaching at the Institute, and I was there for 11 years and then was eventually kind of enticed to come to work at the Society of Genealogists. Again, there was a maternity leave post that was supposed to arrange some cover for that, but I'd got kind of inkling that that was going to lead to a longer association with the society.
Okay.
So I went and started working in the library at the Society of Genealogists, and that was in 1994. And then when the director, Anthony Camp, retired, there was a big shake-up, and they appointed a new chief executive of the society who was more of an administrator at the time.
Okay.
And needed a genealogy specialist on the management team. And so my role entirely changed. And that's from 2000 on, I became the sort of specialist genealogist on the management team at the Society of Genealogists.
And so all of this time you were saying you were working in genealogy, but you weren't tracing your own family tree?
Well, of course, you can't have a surname like mine, like Churchill, without having grown up saying, are you related? But I hadn't really done anything to prove if I was in, had any connection with the famous Churchill families at all. But, you know, it's like, well, I mean, you know, I'm in the best place to start looking. Yeah. So as I learned my skills as a genealogist, I applied them to my own family and was researching the Churchill family for 40 odd years as well.
Wow.
And yeah, so I obviously got into my own family history in a big way. And my mother's German.
Okay.
So I tended to end up with helping the research teams at Achievements, which was the professional research company associated with the Institute in Canterbury. I ended up helping them with their European stuff because I'd had languages and I could speak German.
Okay.
And I was doing a lot of German research, from which my mother had actually found was a bit distasteful because she'd grown up in Germany in the 20s and 30s.
Okay.
When genealogy had a bit of a bad reputation and was really, yes, sort of proving you weren't Jewish, and she thought, you know, digging into this isn't really,
no,
helpful, and it could be, and it really could be dangerous for some people, you know. But I had several cases where I had to find and translate what were known as the Ahnentafel, the ancestral papers for people who were proving they were, mm-hmm, you know, 25% Jewish, you know, the sort of horrible gradations of Jewishness that the bureaucracy would show.
Yeah.
And I could understand my mum had reservations about that.
Yeah.
But I kind of wore her down because it turns out she had an innate skill at German paleography. She could read the documents that were, most of us were looking at, saying, I don't even know where this word begins and ends. You know, this is amazing. But she had grown up reading that handwriting. And so I kind of got her interested in the idea of it by she would read documents for anyone doing German genealogy.
You bonded in genealogy over some old German handwriting.
We did. And she came around thinking, oh, it is fascinating and interesting. And she told me lots and lots of stories, which had an influence on some of the other research I was doing and, mm-hmm, made me start thinking about, you know, family history from the point of view of those that aren't necessarily as intrigued. It was funny, I have other cousins who find family history intrusive and don't really know why I'm doing it. And I find that interesting that there are people who aren't as nosy or as curious as me.
Nosy's good, though. It's a good thing to be if you're a genealogist.
I think you have to have the kind of mind that likes puzzles,
yeah,
detective stories. You know, I love, of course, the basic genealogy questions. Who, what, where, when? You know, those are all the basic things. And the one I love is the why.
Yeah.
You know, can you hypothesise and get the evidence to say, why did that happen? You know, why did they meet there and why did that come about? And making those kind of connections.
Yeah. So what do you think is the most exciting part of doing family history?
Oh, I love the wow moment. You cannot help but smile when you're working in the library of the Society of Genealogists, when we have a library and it's open, but yep, you're working around and you hear a little, yes, oh, and then you know that someone's looked round and you think, yeah, that's what we're here for. That, you know, because there is that feeling of triumph, you know, yeah, gotcha moments. And it is a bit like that where you are actually following the trail and something comes up or something you find,
yeah,
or you just find something laugh out loud, silly. I mean, I've been going through parish registers, doing family reconstruction by extracting all the names and doing all the things I could. And then I just found an entry because why is that entry four lines longer than everybody else's? You know, and you want to know, what's the vicar saying here? And, you know, so, and then he's made some very rude comment about the parentage or something. And you think, oh, well, I know what my ancestors were gossiping about when I, and so I like being distracted in research. And that's probably why I wasn't a good case worker on professional researchers.
Okay.
Probably didn't have the discipline to manage my time that I wasn't distracted by looking at something that wasn't related to what I was doing, or spending far too long thoroughly enjoying what the records were showing me.
Do you think that there's a particularly underrated type of record?
I like the what I call the name-rich ones, which aren't necessarily full of the the exact vital event that you want, you know, like the parish registers or birth records. But I like this idea of building up the story of people in a certain time in a certain place.
Yep.
And so just doing that sort of that chronology of what's going on and building up. Oh, there's a little snippet here that's unique to this parish. It might be, you know, effectively the vicar might have been encouraged at the outbreak of the Napoleonic Wars to make a census of all his parish in case he was drawn upon to protect them. And I found something like that before. And I just love the idea. You know, they're worried about invasion. They had to make a note of who the people were. And so I just like that little thing you come across when you're scouring through the catalogues and something, you know, what is that? You know, and it's not online. And you've chugged up to the archive, and they said, well, we've got a whole paper list of here of all the sources for this place, and you know, you're going through the paper lists, and something just intrigues you. So I want to have a look at that. I'll pull it up just to see, and then you've wasted 2.5 hours, but had a great time, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Now I have a bit of a confession, Elsa.
Mm-hmm.
And it's that I have never visited the Society of Genealogists. And I think in my head, this is perhaps because I imagine that because my ancestors are kind of 90% Cambridgeshire, 5% Norfolk, 5% Somerset, I struggle to imagine what it might be in the Society's collection that would be of relevance to me. So what would there be?
Well, certainly, as soon as we get our new building, I will take you on a personal tour around.
Thank you.
Come up and see us, and I hope we'll make that more, we'll remedy that problem. The Society of Genealogists is the largest and oldest genealogical society in the United Kingdom, mm-hmm. and has been around since 1911. And we recently vacated our fifth building, which was in Charterhouse Buildings in Clerkenwell, and we're looking to move into a new building soon, I hope.
Okay.
But it is over the 100 years that we've been around, we have formed the most remarkable library and resource for anyone who's interested in genealogy and local history. It started out as a library, mm-hmm. bringing in, you know, books relating to the subject. Then we were encouraging, you know, what we would now call crowdsourcing projects by encouraging people to transcribe and index local records. So we ended up having, you know, probably the largest collection of transcripts of local records. And then as these records became more available, from archives, you could get surrogate copies of them. So we'd not only have transcripts of them, but we'd actually get the originals and what was whizzy technology by getting microfilm and microfiche copies of them. So you could always check that the transcriptions were correct. And then, but it wasn't just parish registers. It was huge amounts of things like monumental inscriptions and a fantastic resource. So if you were like me, you had ancestors from different counties. So I've got lines from Herefordshire and Essex and Wales. It was the ability to bring all sorts of records and transcripts and finding aids together. But it wasn't just records, because as you say, records have started, you know, have been, the originals are in local record offices. There are other online resources from them. It was also the fact that it was the encouraging people to write their family history. We were the first to say that everybody's got family history, and it's not just those that got land and property who just happen to be better documented, mm-hmm. whose family history should be researched with any rigour and thoroughness.
Yeah.
So we decided that, you know, it's a bit pompous, but it was, remember, this was the 60s. This is the idea of the genealogy of the common man.
Okay.
Everybody, you know, which was quite, it was quite revolutionary to say that 60 years ago.
Yes. Yeah.
To say that everybody's got roots, and that's effectively what our motto is, you know, everyone, you know, let's all go and look for our family history, whether you are descended from Horatio Nelson, who fought at Trafalgar, or whether you're descended from the rope makers who made the ropes in Chatham Dockyard for the ships. You know, there is that contribution of the story, mm-hmm. is there to say. So we were the first to say that everybody's got roots. Why not go and find out about them? Everybody's should have the same opportunity, so that we're very keen on educating. And although we have had a professional research company in practice in the past, we don't now. We do not do your family history for you. Plenty of our members happen to be professionals, but membership of the Society of Genealogists isn't a professional qualification.
Okay.
We bring together anyone who's interested in family history. Mm-hmm. But we do think that it's much more fun to do it yourself.
Yes.
And so we want to give you the resources to be confident to go into those resources. And so we have a very active education program, short talks, longer skills courses. We partner with things like Pharos for the online learning with intermediate and advanced family history skills. Mm-hmm. So we're very keen on giving you the opportunity to learn how to trace your family history, and also encourage you to do it. And so a huge part of our library are literally thousands and thousands of compiled family histories, mm-hmm. where people may have just done a few, one for themselves, perhaps a few for the family. And, it's a remarkable place where people have lodged their family history research with us.
Okay.
And then accompanying the narrative family histories, people have got, research notes, collections of where people have researched lots of families. Where do the papers of the genealogist who was researching before the internet age go? Because they didn't have blogs and genealogy gedcoms. They had paper, and that generation was dying off in many ways.
Yeah.
And so the last 20 years really was the growth of other people's collections, and some of those collections were very specialist.
Yeah.
So when the papers of someone like Chris Watts, who wrote the book My Ancestor Was a Merchant Seaman and was the expert in that field, a lot of the casework he did as a professional researcher were merchant seaman families, and so things like his case papers may come to us. So some of our collections may be very specialist case paper genealogy research. Some of it just may be one person that's done lots of families that are interconnected and need to be kept. But some of our manuscript notes are just quite random, and people's stuff.
Okay.
It could be, I've got some certificates that aren't related to me, but maybe somebody else could find them of interest. Or here's some extracts of records I've made that somebody else might find of interest. So we've got our special collections and our document collections of research notes. And then following on from there, we occasionally have become an archive almost of last resort, whereby there are original records that haven't found a home in a record office that you'd expect.
Okay.
So, for example, when the Department of Education said it didn't want the Teachers Registration Council registers showing people who'd registered with the council from about 1908 to 1948 prior to the Butler Education Act, they didn't care who. The Department of Education's job wasn't to look after teachers.
Yeah, they just get rid of them. Yeah.
Yeah. National Archives said, well, we don't want it because registration wasn't compulsory. It's not every teacher, but it's a mm-hmm. fair chunk of them. And that wasn't, National Archives, it turned it down. But basically, they were hawking them around to try and find a home for them until we said, hang on, of course we'll take them. So that's just one of a number of odd original records that we've ended up with because nobody else wanted them.
Sure.
Some of them vast.
What is the oddest or most awkward to store in the Society's archive?
We are puzzling over some big things. We're just trying to work out what to do with thousands of volumes of the Engineering Workers Union records for various branches for about 100 years. We've got, we took them in because nobody else wanted them, but they're a lawfully big chunk of records, And as we're sort of moving stores and things like that, we're trying to work out, what can we do with these things to make them more accessible, and can we afford to digitise them, and how much is it going to cost us to digitise them? And it's a significant sum, things like that. So that's so the big, big chunks of records are a challenge for us. But we also end up with niche things, often, particularly someone's life interest or hobbies. So the Eileen Stage work, who she was known as being the lady you'd go to if you had an interest in Coast Guards.
Okay.
And she did lots of notes going through records at National Archives and elsewhere. National Archives didn't want her collection because she hadn't only used their records, But again, that area of expertise and specialism is something we don't want to lose all that work that she'd done.
Sure.
And by digitising her notes, we actually make it a little bit easier to get into some of the records relating to Coast Guards, which are at the National Archives, which haven't got easy indexes and things like that.
Okay.
So that's something that's quite niche and specialised. And I just think it's the sheer variety of things that the Society's got that you think, oh, I never knew that. Oh, yeah, that's really interesting. And our archive collections are really only accessible hitherto by some of the paper lists we have in the archive listing them. Closure for COVID and then closure for getting ready for moving, we're doing a huge amount of work bringing new cataloguing systems online so that we can start telling people about all these wonderful collections we've got in the archives so that you can even at least use the catalogue even before we digitise more.
Sure.
So that's been really what's kept us going, is just sorting and going through all those. But it is such a remarkable library. It's stunningly interesting.
What do you think is the biggest challenge for the genealogy community right now?
Not being overwhelmed, I think, by all the things that technology has made available for us. We grasp technology brilliantly from the early 2000s, and we're just really learning that maybe the internet is more ephemeral than we thought. People had their own blogs, they had their own websites, and then they disappear and they don't work anymore, and the Internet Archive hasn't indexed the database behind them. One record office may have made a contract with one of the commercial genealogy companies, then that contract ends and all the data suddenly moves on to another, but it's not the same. So that wild west nature of the internet, I think, has become quite a bit of a challenge. And although we've led and grasped it brilliantly, and I have to say paid for it, really, it's genealogies having deep pockets that meant that the National Archives managed to get the ability to digitise huge numbers of records. But by adding value to it, and I appreciate it, without them being indexed and accessible from my armchair, I can't conceive of wanting to go back to any other way of doing family history without access to digitised records. But it's just keeping up with it, I think, is the challenge. You know, just where is what? And then realising that there are gaps in the coverage and it isn't quite the same on this website or on that website, and why? And of course, as we're digitizing our own, we're realizing, you know, some of the technical things that can come up. It's interesting.
It's that time in the show when my guest picks one of their most fascinatingly good, bad, or just plain ugly relatives, and they tell their life story. So, Elsa, who are you going to introduce us to?
Well, I'm probably going to introduce you to my mother and father.
Okay.
Which is interesting because I've been researching the Churchill line for 40 years and thought I'd got back to the 17th century quite happily. Mm-hmm. And I teach family history and I've been using all my discoveries in my teaching.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, right, you know, DNA. This is the time to start using it, show how wonderful autosomal tests can be. I also was interested in a Y chromosome test for the Churchills because in my research that I had, I'd seen the Churchill DNA studies, which were online, which were showing kind of things I felt, you know, Churchill's a locative name. There's quite a few, you know, Church on Hills. And it was showing that, you know, that not everyone with a surname Churchill was in any way necessarily connected, and that there were three or four distinct groupings.
Sure.
Those from Dorset, those from Oxfordshire were very distinctly different. And I was developing quite happily this theory that my Churchills from Herefordshire are probably a distinctly separate group as well, and I'm very interested in all these studies.
Okay.
So I thought, right, okay, I'll take a test and then maybe I'll get some other of the male members of my Churchill family to take the more expensive Y chromosome test. Yeah. But I better get my head around doing a basic autosomal test so that I can understand what's going on here.
Mm-hmm.
My parents have been dead for a while, so that I couldn't do the oldest generation, so it was just me.
Yeah, sure.
But when my mother died, we had the family gatherings and gone through all the papers.
Okay.
And we realised my mum had some amazing photographs and We didn't know the stories behind some of these photographs, but particularly were of my parents in their expat life, as my father was in the army in Cyprus, and there was lots of photographs of them and their Cypriot friends. My brother was in those because he was 8 years older than me. I was born in Cyprus. And so Pete had identified some of these people in the photographs as far as he could tell and remembered them. And was telling me about the life in Cyprus before I was born. Okay. And that's the circumstances that that when I took my DNA test, mm-hmm. which nobody who takes a DNA test should not discount the possibility of being surprised. And the biggest surprise of all came to me was that I turned out to have no English ancestry in my ethnicity.
Okay.
I had recognisably German and North European, which I was expecting, but I had Southern Mediterranean and what was ultimately described as Cypriot results in the ethnicity of my family tree.
It's a bit of a surprise.
Well, yes. It was a bit of a surprise. I was born in Cyprus. Okay, Mum, what haven't you not told me? was essentially the idea.
Okay.
And we started going back through all the photographs and the expat lives and stories that my brother, who is just coming up for 70,
okay.
could remember when he was 8.
Yes.
Yep. And this result came about at Christmas 2019. And we're saying, you know, just who are these people in the photographs? And there was one man's photograph that was coming out quite a lot. Mm-hmm. And he's with my parents, he's with my mother and my brother in his shop in, my brother remembered, was this grocer shop in Larnaca, not too far away from the army barracks where my parents were living. And my brother remembered him as Uncle Chris, very pertinent Uncle Chris. Mm-hmm. And he vaguely thought he's, forgive the stereotyping, Chris Papa something or other. And he thought it began with a P, but he couldn't remember. And that was, right, okay, what's going on here? How can I possibly find out anything about this? Well, I go past the British Library on my way to work.
Okay.
Telephone directories in the 60s for people owning shops in Larnaca. Would they have had telephones in the 60s? And I identified two people called Christoph Pease, who were shopkeepers in Larnaca. I thought, well, this is interesting.
Okay, Uncle Chris, yep.
Something like that, bear these in mind. But it wasn't really doing very much for me. So I went back and looked at the DNA. And I was very lucky to sit down with someone that knew what he was talking about, Dr. Jess Winfield, who is a friend of mine. He's a professional researcher. His PhD was in genetics and had become one, you know, really one of the forefront people of using genetics and genealogy. He'd worked with people like Turi King and things like this. So he knew what he was talking about. So he sat down and said, well, let's just have a look at some of these. And you've got some really quite close matches.
Okay.
And there are a few dead ends when we were looking at some of these close matches. So I did another test on, the first test was with Ancestry.
Okay.
But I did another test on my heritage and came up with somebody who's an even closer match of possibly a first or second cousin. That's when I learned that some communities tend to use sites differently. And mm-hmm. it turns out the Greek Cypriot community uses a lot more of my heritage than 23andMe. Yeah. Okay. And the other thing, which was really lucky, is that the cousin I connected, who was cousin Chris, was that rare person who's done an autosomal test that's got an enormous tree, because every time you do a test, there's, you know, someone's got no tree or three people if you're lucky.
How annoying.
Cousin Chris's tree has probably about 3,000-5,000 people on it.
Okay, that's a good tree.
Absolutely enormous. And he'd helped other people before in similar cases.
Okay.
So and when I contacted him, he answered.
That's good as well.
So that was also quite remarkable. So I explained the circumstances that I had Greek Cypriot ethnicity and I was looking for someone called Chris P. Well, there were quite a few Chris P's on his tree, but none of them, he was never really quite satisfied with them or looking right, you know, what it might be. Mm-hmm. And so he said, well, okay, let's have a look at these photographs. And he's very linked in to the Greek Cypriot diaspora in social media. He runs very thriving Facebook groups. He's involved with lots of other people. And so he literally took these photographs of my mum and Uncle Chris and put them out onto Facebook groups.
Okay.
And within 24 hours, somebody had come back and said, I recognise that photograph. That photograph of that man and that woman was in my uncle's house in Cyprus. And it turns out she was my first cousin. And she could explain the circumstances so that we could fit this man into Cousin Chris's big tree and work out why Cousin Chris and I had come up with a connection, because it turns out we're actually second cousins.
Okay.
And we fitted her into the tree, into his tree. We fitted her father into the tree, and we fitted her uncle into the tree and his parents. And that was phenomenal, that it was just by having this social network that the photograph was connected.
Right.
Now, ideally, first cousin, and I won't give you her name.
Sure.
My first cousin, L, we'll call her. Ideally, she would take a test to triangulate and corroborate this connection. Mm-hmm. She stopped talking. She clearly got a bit freaked by this. And this is where we left it. Until I was at the Society of Genealogists for the Christmas party. All this is happening in November 2019. We're having a Christmas social.
Okay.
And one of our members, a fantastic volunteer, was hearing me regale this story to all who would listen to it. But, you know, well, I've been doing genealogy for 40 years, and guess what? This Churchill family has got nothing to do with my genetics. All right, you know, and this is all quite interesting. And he had said, well, funny enough, I'm going to Cyprus next year. My wife is Greek Cypriot. And we have a holiday home not too far from this village where the cousin had identified the family from coming from.
Okay.
Would you like us to go and do a little bit of digging?
What a wonderful coincidence.
And it was absolutely just having a glass of wine and pontificating in our common room, as we do.
There's a lesson there, I think, for genealogists to have more parties.
I think you're absolutely right. Yes, yes. Tell people about it and get advice.
Yeah.
Because also, I'm going back to the beginning. I'm suddenly learning, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Cypriot genealogy. I'm an absolute beginner at what the resources are. I mean, I know the techniques I should be doing, but finding the records, there aren't that many of them, and things you should be doing, and what you can do remotely. It's good for your hubris to go become a beginner every now and then, and realizing it from the point of view of people who are just starting. It doesn't do you any harm at all.
Yeah, absolutely.
Anyway, so in 2020, I go to Australia to tell my brother all of this story. And Grant, the volunteer, is going to Cyprus.
Okay.
And then COVID comes, of course. We come rushing back from Australia. Grant comes rushing back, but he's got one heck of a story to tell me. He and his wife had gone to the village, and Cyprus has lots and lots of very independent communities, like almost like a parish, if you imagine it, but with a bit like in France, where you have the mairie of a certain area, very, very much lots of responsibility, knows everybody. There's a kind of headman type person who's elected for all these areas.
Okay.
So while Grant and his wife, Anna Maria, are wandering around the village and finding the gravestone and coming up with some remarkable findings in the grave, photographs of the gravestones, which have pictures of my grandparents on the current stone, showing them as when they were young with their births and dates on them.
Perfect.
But they also have the These stones have been refurbished, and laying down next to the modern stone is the stone that was originally put up when showing them when they were very old with pictures. These pictorial gravestones are remarkable, just as well, because I can't, wow. You know, and also Anna Maria translated the Greek for all the transcriptions for me. So as they're taking all this interest, mm-hmm. they're being comment, you know, being noted upon. Who are these people having a good wander around? And they strike up a conversation with an elderly chap and an elderly woman. And it turns out this is the sort of head man of the council. So, you know, what's going on? And they explained the circumstances, that we're researching for a friend who thinks she's connected to this family and would like to learn more. And he says, well, okay, well, if you walk up the road, that's the family house. That's, you know, this is where this particular family have a holiday home. I mean, they don't live in this village anymore, but they come back. So, and I know Cousin L, and clearly he got in contact with Cousin L saying, who's these people investigating what's going on here? I thought I need to tell you. And it's fairly obvious that Cousin L is very worried that I want to get my fingers on the family house or something like that. Sure. Whereas I'm saying, look, I'm not, you know, so I'm sending back messages. I'm really, really not. I just want to know, you know, the genealogy of it, who's what, who his brothers and sisters are,
yeah, sure.
Who your, you know, your family, and can we go back beyond these gravestones of the grandparents, which are in the village, and how do I get, you know, how do I try and get birth, marriage and death certificates, which are actually quite difficult in Cyprus, how do I get the church records? Well, the headman then was put in contact with my cousin Chris, who explained the circumstances even further, saying that Cousin L had stop talking to him, but maybe this other guy could convince him. And he said, well, I'm not sure about this, but I'll try. But by the way, you know, he keeps saying, do you know where the church records, the Orthodox church records are? And they put me in touch with a new priest who said, no, wouldn't that be a really nice question to answer? I've only been here 5 years and I can't find my predecessor's records.
Oh, no.
So this is all going very badly, very badly at the moment. So it's kind of where we've left it. Is that I have a summons from the headman the next time. Okay. If you'd like to come to Cyprus, come and talk to me. And Cousin Chris has said, well, you know, I'll go over there at the same time. And Grant and his wife Anna Maria have said they'll come over with me. So I'll have lots of Greek people supporting me with the language and helping me find things like that. But then I had another third match pop up who contacted me and said that he recognised my father's name in the family tree, and that he had been effectively his great uncle, and he knew him really, really well, and he could tell me lots and lots of stories. And I went back saying, that's really kind of you.
Okay.
I'd love to know these stories. And then that dried up as well.
Okay.
So I am thinking that probably he is the son of Cousin L,
who's had a quiet word
and said no. So at the moment I'm just stepping back, letting somebody else digest the story.
Yeah, it's big news for them as well.
It's big news for them. You know, that they had no idea that this uncle, who had never married apparently,
okay,
but had lots of English lady friends, even though my mother was a German lady friend.
Right.
And then one story that did come out was that he had been a prisoner of war in Germany in the Second World War, mm-hmm. and had spoken German. So maybe that was maybe where some connection had come in, some connection with the German, yeah. And that he actually sort of caretaker for a German couple whose house in Cyprus and things like that. So, and they remember him speaking German with them and things like that. So that's about the only story really I know about him, is that he's a greengrocer that spoke German and clearly met my mum at some point. Yeah. I don't think my dad knew anything about this.
No.
He loved me to pieces. Absolutely no hint, no clue from him.
Okay, yeah.
Some of the stories my mum has told me suddenly are recast in a completely different light.
Oh, okay.
Retrospectively, you kind of think, I'm not sure.
What was she telling you?
I have the story of told by my mother, and my dad backs this up, that their song was never on a Sunday,
right?
Because that's when I was conceived, and there was a very big gap between me and my brother.
Right. Okay.
And my mum had always said that she didn't think she could have any more children, and was very surprised when she'd gone to the doctor to say if I didn't know better, I'd think I was pregnant, and the doctor said, you don't know better. for about 5 months.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering how many people are told stories like that from their parents, unless they're trying to reinforce something or other into you.
Because that's quite specific. It's almost too much detail to cover up something.
Yes, I'm beginning to wonder if that's the case. And my brother, you know, God bless him, we had the big, you know, talk about this. We've got, do you remember as an 8-year-old? How does it affect you? And he said, well, I want to take a DNA test now. Okay. So we went through and talked about the ethics and all the things that might come up and all the same kind of things and be prepared. And his family history triangulates so well into other Churchill lines and threw up a story of another child of my grandfather that my brother connected to. And we could identify, we could work out for this person that my grandfather was probably that person's father. And so all the DNA on the Churchill side seemed to match for Peter quite spectacularly. And there were stories there with, you know, but it does seem that the raciness of life, when you're talking about the affiliation orders and illegitimacies and bastardly bonds of the 18th century, are just, you know, it's life and it's just what happens. And I know many people, I'm not the only person that's had this in the DNA genealogy story at all.
Right.
But I find it fascinating. And the things, it's the insight into it. But I have had friends who've been devastated by finding something like that. And I wasn't. I was a very much loved child. And my dad's was great. And I was the apple of his eye. So if he had any clue, he certainly never gave it to me. And it's just very, very interesting.
Do you think that this Uncle Chris would have known who you are?
I don't know. I just do not know. He's kept the photograph, exactly the same photograph that we put out. That was a connection to who he was. But judging by the photographs, he was a gregarious chap that had lots of lady friends. So I don't know. He never married, but I don't want to cast my mum as the lost love of his life. I suspect that wasn't the case at all. Okay. And you can romanticise any story you want there. And the answer is, I don't know.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
I would be surprised if he knew and my dad didn't, kind of thing, you know, so.
I wonder maybe if there are other half-siblings for you.
Well, the DNA is out there.
Yeah.
If, you know, that would be interesting to see what happens.
Maybe when you do get to visit this village leader, maybe he will kind of mediate a meeting between you and this L cousin?
I think it's possible. I think it probably would be case to say, look, I'm not here for any property transaction. I'm not here for any worrying. I don't want to stir up any bad memories. I will respect whatever boundaries you want to do. Because what I'd now like to know is, what do you know about the grandparents who are in this graveyard that they found? What do you know about their family? And it's such a traditional Greek village, I'd love to know more about the Greek history of it. And it's absolutely beautiful. It's in the mountains in West Cyprus, about an hour's drive from Paphos. So, you know, I've definitely, you know, once travel sorted itself out and a lot easier to go, guess where I'm going next year?
Well, fingers crossed that you get to meet this cousin. I wish you a lot of luck in expanding that part of your tree.
Thoroughly enjoying it so far, I have to say.
Well, thank you, Elsa, for telling the story about your parents. But I think it's now time for you to face
the brick wall.
Brick walls are so annoying, but they're an inevitable blocker in our quest to uncover our family history, lasting for what feels like, well, forever. It's now time for my guests to share one of their brick walls in the hope that one of you, dear listeners, can help with a clue or research idea. So, Elsa, what can we help you with?
Well, I'm still trying to look at the Churchill family. I've been researching them for 40 years, but there's one great, great grandmother I can't quite find.
Okay.
And that is the wife of William Churchill. They were married in St. Wenards,
okay,
in Herefordshire in 1851. And from the censuses, they have three recognisable children. And in all the censuses from 1861 to when she dies in 1905, Mary Davies describes herself as born around 1824, and she is 77 in 1901, and 10 years less in every census, going back to the census I can find her in 1861.
Okay.
And she consistently says she's born in Madeley in Herefordshire, which is right on that border between Herefordshire and Monmouthshire.
Okay.
There are two possible baptisms on Family Search. One is Mary Davies, the daughter of Catherine Davies, in 1825 in Madeley.
Yep, potential there.
And the other is Mary Ann Davies, daughter of James Davies and Mary, in January 1826 in Madeley.
Oh, okay. Less helpful. Okay.
So I've got two in Madeley. About the right time.
That's annoying. Okay.
Yep. So her maiden name is Davies from her marriage, and the maiden name given on the three children that appear in the census.
And just to clarify, that's Davies, D-A-V-I-S?
It's a bit of both, to be perfectly honest. It's D-A-V-I-E-S mostly. Mostly Davies.
Okay.
In 1851, before the marriage, they married in October 1851, there is a Mary Davies in the same parish where the banns were called for this marriage. This is a little parish called Rockwell, just going slightly more over to the Welsh border.
Yep.
And if that Mary Davies, the female servant, born Madeley in that parish of St Maun's, which contains the parish, the hamlet of Rockwell, and things like that, if that is her, she is living very close to the vicar who married them. And she, again, is saying that she's born Madeley in 1851. This is all adding to the Madeleys. So I need to look at her marriage certificate from the church records to confirm what she says about her father. Does she say James?
Mm-hmm.
Or is there no father's name mentioned? Either of which would be good to confirm.
Or a made-up one.
Or a made-up one, because she certainly names her father as Richard. Okay. In the 1841 census, a Mary Davies, aged 18, so making her born about 1823, is living with Richard Davies, aged 45, an agricultural labourer, and Elizabeth Davies, aged 40, described as their daughter, in the parish of Brainton in Herefordshire, which is almost neighbouring Madeley.
Right, okay.
All born in the same county in the 1841 census. The problem is, in the 1851 census, Mary is still in that household, but that's just a few months before the marriage. But that means she cannot be the one I found in 1851 living near the vicar. She can't be that servant. But in that 1851 census, all that household do not say they're born Madeley. They say they're born in another parish called Titley. So why does she say Madeley from 61 constantly onwards?
Mm-hmm.
But this household with the Richard is saying born in somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
And indeed, there is a baptism for Mary, daughter of Richard, in the Titley parish registers in August 1823,
right, okay.
Which is just that wrong bit for everything she says about herself after 1861.
It feels like you've probably found about four Mary Davies.
Yes,
there.
I have. Yes, absolutely. So I can then throw another spanner into the works. From the censuses, I'd identified three children, but they were born from about 5 years after the marriage. All those children had the mother's maiden name as Davies, tie in with the marriage perfectly. Going through the actual parish registers of where they were living, they're living in a parish called Broadoak, which is half in Galway and half in St Wenard's. And I think this is the parish registers of St Wenard's. There's a burial of a child of William and Mary Churchill, and I can find a baptism a couple of years later. And she's born in the intervening census years. So I think she's born around 1854 and dies 1860. There's no other William and Mary anywhere around in the censuses, and there's no other marriage of William and Mary around that area for her to be the child of a different couple. So I get her birth certificate. Only the mother's maiden name on this child, Harriet Churchill, born 1854, is Morgan.
Right, okay.
And on the marriage certificate of Mary Davies, daughter of Richard, and William Churchill, who marry at St Maun's in 1851 in Monmouthshire, there is a Mary Morgan who is a witness. And that's where I've left it.
Wow, that is quite a puzzle. But if one of the listeners has an idea or a clue that could help you, what's the best way for them to make contact?
Ooh, I think just email me, elsa.churchill@sog.org.uk.
And of course, listeners can go to familyhistoriespodcast.com and you can click on the contact form. And if you send us a message, we'll pass that straight on to Elsa. Let's imagine maybe you had, I don't know, a free trip in a time machine somewhere, and you could go to a particular place and date to solve this for yourself. When and where would you choose?
Well, if I was solving this, I'd want to go to those parishes on the Welsh border between, I think, 1825 and 1870. I'd like a second time machine visit, and I want to go back to Cyprus in 1961. Just to see what's going on there, please.
Well, whilst the listeners go searching for clues, I think I might just be able to help you with that.
All right.
But you're going to need to follow me through to the garage.
Sounds intriguing.
Here we are.
What's that smell?
Oh, don't worry about that. It's just Shandor Paterfi.
Hello.
Well, not him specifically. I don't think so, anyway.
Shouldn't he be dead by now?
Shh, no spoilers. He's just a little hiccup in time, all right? And for a 19th century poet, he's remarkably good with electronics. Now, where was I?
Being helpful?
Oh, yes. Well, Elsa, here we are, one time machine.
Don't be daft. This?
Ah, but this is a fully functioning, highly scientifically calibrated machine.
Is there a punchline?
No, but if you grab a seat, I'll demonstrate it. Yeah, that's fine. Okay, so I thought you might like to pop back in time to see if you can solve your brick wall for yourself.
Okay, what do I have to do?
But, as it's you, I'm bending the rules. You could go and find Mary Davies, or you might just have some when else in mind instead. It's your choice.
Mary's intrigued me so much. But no, 8th of September 1960, Cretu Terror in Cyprus.
It's a deal.
You need this.
What is it?
Ah, yes. Temporal beacon. When you're ready to come home, just press the big button and you'll be zapped right back here.
Okay.
Right, we're all set. Here we go. Elsa Churchill. Thank you, goodbye, and good luck.
Wow.
How'd we do?
Spot on.
Thank goodness for that. That could have been awkward. The Family Histories podcast was presented and produced by me, Andrew Martin. My guest was the brilliant Elsa Churchill with John Spike as Shandor Paterfi. If you've enjoyed this episode, then click subscribe to get the next one, or please consider leaving us a rating or review. Thank you. Approximately no family historians were harmed in the making of this podcast.